These two radios look different on the outside, but they both share the same chassis. However, if these were considered twin sisters, this one's the fairly dowdy one. This one is the more glamorous.
Well, I've seen a number of these stories where people felt like they, you know, somebody took their money.
This is a Marconiphone P17B. Came out about the same time as the EverReady Model B. With a prettier cabinet. Same principle. Lid activated switch. Antenna in the lid. Tuning scale is in meters instead of kilocycles, but done in a very beautiful chrome control panel and cabinet. This is a very sensitive receiver. What's on right now is WLW in Cincinnati. I'm in Indianapolis. And it's pulling it in within a metal building, which is said to be, that's something to be said. I'll go on ahead and tune.
Why are they hanging on to this, and why
very
didn't they make a change?
Volume, I might
make
add.
A change mid-season?
Well, because, I mean, I think the fact that there's a contract there...
This one tuned up very well.
...up to the contract, but it's also paying somebody to not coach, and I think in many ways...
Dispatch, he'll join us in a couple of minutes from now. Just, what are the...
And you hear Jonah saying... Oh,
here's the chassis, very much identical to the Model B, with the fabric, Bakelite impregnated fabric cover to protect the chassis. This is the one that I told you all was the one I had to completely tear down to bits and pieces and rebuild it from scratch. I bought this about 12 years ago from a guy named, I believe his name was Enrico Tedeschi, and it was about the only one I'd ever come across. This radio was a basket case. The speaker was shot. The tubes were all blown because somebody had tried wiring up separate batteries and probably got the B where the A was, and the A where the B was blew out all the filaments. And on top of that, the chassis had a short circuit, and all the wires inside are black. So it was almost impossible to trace it down. Here are two of the tubes. I had to completely retube it. I don't think I had to do anything with the wiring harness. I just had to clean it back up after I took it all down to pieces. Here's another one of the tubes. There's another one behind this IF core. But all of this chassis had to be completely taken apart. I happen to have schematics. I did a step-by-step instructional guide and rebuilt this radio almost just like a Heath kit. And by the time I got done, I had a working radio. Took about a couple of weeks, and I don't mind telling you there were a couple of times I think I almost wanted to take up drinking as a second hobby because of this set. But as you heard in the previous segments here, it was all well worth it. And I've got a rare personal set now as a result of it. Once again, this radio uses the infamous B114 battery, which is 69 volts on the B side, 1.5 volts on the A, and I'll be devoting a video just to it. This was the radio, as a matter of fact, that led to the inspiration of actually finally getting around to building one of these. I started in earnest about 10 years ago, this month, as a matter of fact. Put it aside, tried a few other things, put it aside, and finally was able to come up with what I'm satisfied with as a viable option and durable option for these particular batteries. All right, I have this radio tuned up to the Spanish music station. So turn it on just like the Model B. Pop the lid. The only other fault here is this latch is broken. So everything's activated by this one. Normally it would have two latches, but one worked just fine. Plus, it's missing a couple of screws. I'm not worried about it. After what I went through, just to hear it play was worth it. You may have seen a radio like this in an earlier video, which was an Australian Mullard. This is the radio that it was based on. This is the True British Ever Ready Model B.
Should have had a comment after the game talking about the play calling responsibilities.
Am I like the offensive coordinator then? You're the head coach and I should have done that and then...
And here's not Jim Zorn.
The difference between the Mullard and this radio, this is the original that came out about the late 40s. The difference is in this battery, which I finally built, and I will devote a video just to this. This is a combination HT and LT, if I go by the British vernacular, or A and B pack in the American vernacular. This has both the filament voltages and the high voltages all wrapped up in one package. It's called a B114. I have been working on making a reasonably decent working model for almost 10 years off and on. I believe I finally got it down pat. The other thing that I didn't have listed in the Mullard video was a good shot of the chassis. This one unfortunately does not have its protective bakelite cover as it's supposed to have, because you can see the screw hole here. But on the plus side, it gives everyone the opportunity to see how this chassis was put together. This is a personal set, and because of that, all the parts are tightly packed together, almost like a watch. And in fact, these particular radios, I actually had to completely tear one down and rebuild it because it had a short circuit in it. You might notice in this model, all the wires are black except for the wiring harness. So when you have a short circuit and you're trying to track it down and all the wires are black, it's a little bit difficult to do that. So I tore one completely apart and redid it. This is the oscillator coil. These two white wires are the antenna wires. Of course, your tuning capacitor, your volume control with its associated capacitors are over here. Some of the tubes. I always like this little resistor pack that they put in here, nice and tidy. And then, of course, the holder for the battery. And the battery itself. And your on-off switch is right here. And these are your IF cores. And they have small little, I guess you call them spade lugs, for the tuning screws. You have to have a special tool that has a slot in it and tune them that way. Here's the paperwork. Ever Ready Personal Receiver Model B. And shows you how to take the battery out. Once again, I'll play the radio to turn it on. You simply hit these two latches.
And then he refused to leave.
Radio starts playing just like a music box.
And wasn't it Jack Youngblood who did play in the Super Bowl with a broken leg?
Another one.
Tuning dial is in meters, not kilocycles.
If you're in the same spot 6 months or even a year from now, how are you going to feel? If you don't want to be there, pick up the phone and call me. 846-9200.
Antenna's in the lid here. Now, they also had a two-bander model of this type.
But if you're serious about breaking,
I believe it had a band switch right here for medium wave and the other for long wave. But this one's the medium wave only.
Reese Nichols presents the Go Blue Jewelry Collection.
because a real genius would buy her some.
It's going to have to be some kind of a, you know, a Q&A where he's going to at least have to come out and deny things, or he's going to have to admit something. He just can't hide anymore. Like, that was a perfect word. You said he.
This is one of my favorite British personal portables. It's a Marconi P20B, came out about 1948. I got this from Bob Thompson in Britain. He's the guy who has the website where he shows off most of his collection, and he also has some reproduction battery covers available that you can print out, cut out, and put together for your own portables. Top and bottom pieces are plastic with a snakeskin middle band. And this is also one of the radios that uses the B114 combination battery pack. I'll go ahead and turn it on. Antenna is in the lid just like any other personal set. This one is unique in that it is not AM only. It's medium wave, which is AM, but it's also long wave. And you switch over between the two bands with this switch. Switch needs to be cleaned a little bit because of all the crackle. It's a little hesitant. But she does play. When it wants to. I actually need to clean that. We'll get away from the Spanish version of Alvin and the Chipmunks. Did I mention I really need to clean that band switch?
He's calling the place for a team and he's barely been there. What's going on? This is a joke. It's a debacle. End it. Just end it. End it for Jim Zorn's sake, for everybody's sake. End this thing and let's
move on. Mike in the morning, weekdays, 6 to 10 on 1070 The Fan.
Drive home a Buick Enclave today. The finest luxury crossover ever. Get zero.
Please. There's going to be people trying to ask the players.
It's a very easy to tune radio, and it's a fairly sensitive model too.
Latest hitting slump. The other thing, Dan.
Okay, to access the inside, there's a small button you press here, and the panel lifts up. Here's the information on the set. P20B. With the license, you had to have a license in order to listen to it. Here's the chassis. Here are your tubes, your IF transformers, a couple of adjustments, and the B114 battery which I built. I'll go ahead and lift it out so you can see the rest of the chassis. There's the speaker and the output transformer. Battery just lifts in and is placed inside the receiver nice and gently. We'll try one more time. Kids and trained animals. They won't perform on camera. They'll perform any other time except when they're on camera. And then to turn off the radio, it's just a matter of closing the lid. And in normal circumstances, grabbing the handle, taking it with you, but unfortunately, one other flaw, missing the handle. But there you have it, a full-blown four-tube super hat, all in a nice small package. This is another one of those unique personal portables. From the outset, if you're familiar with British radios, it looks like on the outside to be a British Ever Ready Model B personal set, but that's not the case here. This is a Mullard. It is the Model B chassis, even the Model B design, except it's made in Australia. Four-tube supercut, just like all the other ones, with a brushed chrome and black control panel. Looks very much like the first Emerson personal portable from over here. Tuning knob is up here, and it's listed in meters instead of kilohertz.
I'm stuck for the next 5,000 miles.
See? Everybody wins.
Genuine and thumb wheel here for the volume control. The antenna located here in the lid, and then these two small straps here are the actual antenna leads. You can get it real closely here. Don't know if you can see it, but there's the Mullard logo. There's also a logo here. And then to turn the set on and off, it's just a matter of closing or opening the case. Opening the case, all you have to do is just hit this little latch here, and the top comes out. And as you can see, it is an Australian radio, has the ARTS&P stamp in here. That definitely makes it an Australian set. Ever Ready personal receiver, model 49. The only difference between this one and the Model B from Ever Ready is that the Mullard here uses the standard 467 B battery and the D cell. As you can see here, I've done them in Australian diamond graphics. The Model B uses a combination A and B pack called a B114. It takes up this entire spot here. And inside, here are the tubes. The chassis is in this Bakelite impregnated fabric cover. And without further ado, I'll turn it back on again. One.
Tonight mostly cloudy with a low around 44. Wednesday mostly sunny, a little bit warmer with the highs in the mid-60s.
Then there's John Tim. Oh, that guy with the short shorts from the gym.
Why would you invite him?
You overheard me telling Ryan the wings are specially priced and he really wanted to come out.
I told him to wear jeans.
Oh.
You know, a big-time IU fan or defender here. Like I say, I lost the game because of...
any high-profile player being injured. We've seen it with the Chad Pennington situation so far right now in Miami. But good...
As I promised in the last two or three videos, I would do one entirely to this. 10 years ago, I set out to make one of these, and off and on, I worked on it, trying to come up with better solutions, and I finally did. This is the Ever Ready B114 combination AB pack, or in Britain, they would call it an HT, which is high tension, your high voltage, and low tension, LT. Battery. A little bit bigger in a box, a pack of cigarettes, probably about two packs of cigarettes, I would say. And I will show the inside in just a minute. I've done this in what would be British Ever Ready's 1950s graphics. To plug it into one of the personal receivers, there's a 4-pin plug. Or a 4-pin socket here, I should say. 4-pin plug would go into this. Everything's listed out. Here are your negative leads and your positive leads. Here's the harness. It's made out of four pieces of circuit board, soldered together with brass strips. On one side, 7-9 volt batteries, and then for the filament side, a single C cell. Like I say, I've been working on this for about 10 years, trying to come up with a solution. What finally did the proper push for me was I just recently created a 467, 67.5 volt battery using two pieces of circuit board. Well, one of these batteries is nothing more than just one of those 467s with a single C cell attached to it. So all I did was adapt the 467 part, which is here, and then expanded it out to this box. The other thing I did was, if you notice, everything on all three sides are the foil side, such as this. Here on the front, I wanted to make sure it was insulated because I didn't want any short circuits. So what I did is I reversed it. This is the actual insulated side. And then I just brought out the leads, if you will, the traces, out to here, each part of the socket. Now, the only ones I really didn't do that directly with were the A batteries. I could just wire those up to the socket pins. But aside from those two wires, there's not a single wire in this entire battery. And the whole assembly lifts out as one. And it's just a simple matter of loading up your 9 volts in the C-cell, sliding it into that cover. Now, it's still a little bit rough. I've got a lot of marker on here. This was for my own reference. This is the prototype, if you will. The later battery won't have near as much excess solder or excess holes, if you will. I had to make a lot of adjustments to make this all fit. And it just fits in a Model B, and there's good wiggle room in the Marconiphone P17B and P20B. So I've hit it on the mark. Only other thing I wanted to do was to make sure that the C-cell would be held right, so I put some brass strips in and used the foil side on some of the circuit board pieces to hold it in place.
Like the radio?